Welcome everyone to our 15th annual Division of Enrollment Management and Marketing Annual Meeting. It is really a pleasure to have you with us today. For those of you who I have not met yet, I'm Jane McGrath. I am the Associate Vice President for Division Planning and Management, as well as the Career Center. So again, it is very nice to have you here. You'll notice that today is March 15th, and it is our 15th annual meeting. And therefore, we have a little bit of a theme that goes around those 15 years. So you'll see that throughout my remarks, at least. A little bit of housekeeping first. For those of you who have participated in our networking event, if you want to complete these forms, make sure your name is at the bottom of them. Sandra and Lauren will walk around in the next few minutes to collect your cards, so make sure these are filled out. I also hope that during the past 30 minutes, you were able to meet some new people and to begin to grow your DePaul network even a little bit more. It's kind of interesting to see that we have about 25 different departments, different budget line items. So a lot of times you just don't have the natural reasons to get connected, and that's one of the reasons why we host this annual meeting, so that you can connect with people. It's also one of the reasons why we kind of force your seating. We intentionally have you mixed up with a bunch of different people, with the full intent that you build and grow your network. Before launching into the business portion of today, I ask that you allow me to take a few minutes to thank some people who were behind the scenes and making all of this great event happen. Thank you to Lauren Chris. Lauren is right outside there. Lauren really did a lot of the heavy lifting for this, and Lauren, your work is remarkable and your attitude is tremendous, so thank you for that. I've also heard from a number of you that the wine selection was really good today. So Lauren, thank you. You might plan that for next year too. So thanks for that. Also behind the scenes is Sandra Chaplin. Sandra keeps the agenda really focused. And for those of you who know me, I tend to ramble and I can be all over the place. Thanks to Sandra, she has made sure that this annual meeting is not a five-hour meeting. Otherwise it might be. And finally, I'd like to acknowledge Brady Johnson. Brady Johnson is really the special content advisor to our keynote speaker, David Kalsbeek. So I appreciate we appreciate your work with that too, Brady. So thank you to all three of you. Okay, so now the forced fun and the table activity. And this actually I think might be kind of interesting. The center of your each table is a grid that looks like this, and it's a timeline from 2002 all the way to 2016, representing 15 years. Also in an envelope are little slips of paper, and these papers reflect some of the milestone events that have occurred in the past 15 years. Let me just be clear, it's only some. We have countless different accomplishments throughout these 15 years. Your goal as a table is to put each of the events in chronological order on your grid. You have tape there as well. But before you begin, a couple things. First, we ask that you introduce yourself to each other. What's your name? What department? How long have you been at DePaul? So start with that. And then also, some of you haven't been here for 15 years, so you may not have any idea of when these different things happen. And you know what? There are really good hints on all of these pages, slips of paper, that will help you figure out the order of these events. So have at it. I'll give you a 5-minute warning once you wrap this up, but you can begin the exercise now. So now let's move on to see how everyone did with our timeline. So before I give you the answers, let me just say that behind this chronological order of all the things that happened, really what's behind this are all the people who made this happen and the people who make so many things happen in the division. So none of this could have happened without a talented and engaged workforce. So let me begin. So in 2002, we launched the first prospective student website. Everyone got that right?
Yeah.
Okay, Patrick Valdez and Sherry Miller, I sure hope you got that one right. Then in 2003, a couple things happened in 2003. We launched the first ever career outcomes brochure, which was produced in 2003, and now it's really turned into something that's just core with everything that we do. In addition to the career outcomes book, we also launched a brand architecture program, which, if you can see, this is what DePaul used to look like to the public, with all sorts of different logos, different treatments for DePaul. So that was a huge, huge thing. Verna Donovan, in her first stint, oversaw that. Next on the list is in 2004, transfer articulation and degree audit were centralized within the division. It used to be so decentralized. Every college office did a little bit of their part, did it differently. Anyone here remember the TADA project? Okay, a few. Saw a few hands back there. So that was a significant year. Pam, Mark, and Maria, I know you did. So if you didn't raise your hands, you should have. In 2005, next was we opened the Wish Welcome Center. Everyone get that one right?
Yep.
Okay, the Wish Welcome Center was a really big deal because for the first time we, at the downtown campus, we had street side presence where it was easy for visitors to find us. So that was a really important move for us. In 2006, DePaul Central opened at the Lincoln Park campus. Michael Lindsay, are you here? I see Michael's probably working. Michael Lindsay was one of the first ones who transitioned over from financial aid into DePaul Central at the Lincoln Park campus. Also in 2006 was the GEMS, which is Graduate Enrollment and Marketing Services concept. Andre Lewis was instrumental with that, as well as Ann Spittle. Many of you were involved in that GEMS rollout, and the degree progress report also occurred at that time. 2006 was an incredibly transformational year for our division. It is when our division started to grow at a very rapid pace, in part because of all these things that happened in 2006. Next, in 2007, who got this one right, where we changed our name from the Division of Enrollment Management to the Division of Enrollment Management and Marketing. How many were here who remember? This is one of our table guineas, the M&Ms with the blue and red M&Ms. That was to acknowledge and to celebrate the name change. 2008, we created the Center for Access and Attainment. And it was also another extremely busy year. We renovated the 11th floor of 55 East Jackson. It was one of those things that a few of us roamed that building and said, where can we find some space? And we roamed onto this empty 11th floor and said, we envision something different, something better. For those of you who work in admission operations right now, you know that you used to work in a storage closet. So what it was then compared to what it is today is absolutely incredible, and also transformed the way we worked together with all of the different enrollment related things. In addition to in 2008, institutional planning, OIPR merged with EMR to create IRMA, and that was in 2008. And the Center for Access and Attainment was also established in 2008, so a lot went on in that year. In 2009, the Lincoln Park Welcome Center opened at the Lincoln Park Center. Carlene, where are you, Carlene? I believe this was your third or fourth Lincoln Park office that you opened in your 25 years of being here. Is that right? So So this was the third Welcome Center. It's really world-class right now. So that happened in 2009. By the way, Carlene, congratulations on your 25th anniversary. That happened just a couple weeks ago. And also in 2009, the competency model launched within the division, and as Tina Cahigas can attest to, that also transformed the way we did business here in the division. 2010, who got this one right? The DePaul Admission Partnership Program, the DAP program, launched with community colleges. David and Lois, your work has transformed this into a best practice and is nationally known for the work you did and the work you started to create back in 2010. 2011, DePaul is the first largest private institution to offer a test optional admission. 2010, DePaul's alliance with Rosalind Franklin University of Medicine and Science is announced. And you'll also hear more about that later this afternoon. Here's an important milestone as well. The Corporate and Employer Outreach Program, what we refer to as CEO, this initiative launched in 2013. I vividly recall Dara Crowfoot coming to me and saying that she was very confident that she could lead this effort. And there's no doubt that, that you have led it very effectively with a great team too. In 2014, how's everyone doing on their list? Everyone okay, getting 100% yet? Blue Star launched. This was a great joint effort between a number of offices. It's an online system that supports our students' academic success. At the same time, in 2004, the online scholarship tool launched, and that is just a comprehensive resource for our students to search for scholarships. Through Blue Star, we were lucky to get Ruben Picasso. Ruben, are you here? Well, I guess he's back at work also. And he led much of the training and implementation of Blue Star. And the scholarship team, led by Amy, Angela, Paul, and Paige, our students have better access to scholarship information because of your good work. So thank you for that. Moving on, two more years to go. In 2015, the Career Center remodel the space at the Lincoln Park campus. This came about in part when Ed Childs said that the Lincoln Park Center needed to be less corporate and more inviting. So I'm going to encourage each and every one of you to follow Ed's lead, and when you think that there might be an opportunity to take into account how our students experience our space and or our services, to make your opinions be known, because it does make a difference. Also, oops, let me go back to one last thing for 2015. Federal funding for student support services. It's one of our TRIO programs. We were funded again. The program was renewed for another 5 years with an almost perfect score by the Department of Education. Unheard of, but it just speaks to the great success that we have already had with our TRIO programs. And finally, in 2016, SLATE, we launched SLATE at the undergraduate level, and now we're working on the implementation for our graduate programs now. And then we also had a full redesign of DePaul.edu, and it was based on our brand work of urban educated and world ready. So these are the things that occurred in chronological order. So how'd everyone do? Which tables had them all right? Oh, okay. All right, well, if you want, we can send out the answer key if you'd like. So, of course, I'd like to just spend a few more minutes. Of course, behind these 15 years, this timeline, and all the accomplishments, everything behind it really is you. It is our employees that make a difference, no matter what department it is. what department you sit in, you have had an impact at DePaul and in enrollment management and marketing. Every year, I like to give you a bit of a glimpse into our workforce, so let me share a few things with you today. Today, there are 18 people here with us today for whom this is the first annual meeting. So for the 18 of you, would you please stand and be acknowledged. And we always put the newest employee on the spot. So Jeremy Roden is our new articulation encoder and track. He is our newest staff member, and he joined us on February 20th. Jeremy, I'm going to ask you to stand up so people can see. And then I also have a few shout outs, and the list could go on with some of the shout outs, but let me just say that in this past year, Carolyn Horan and Ruben Picasso both received the Staff Quality Service Award. It's a prestigious university-wide award, and it's nice that two of us received that award. So thank you for your good work. Entering the 25-year club this year was Michael Lindsay, and Michael was also selected to be one of the keynote speakers at that celebration. Last year, Jeff Setness was also inducted into the 25-year club, but you weren't able to be with us last year, so I just want to say thank you and congratulations to you from 25 years ago last year. Thank you. And there were also, you talk about years of service, there were 40 of us who were recognized through the service awards, whether it be 5, 10, 15, 20 plus years of service in the annual awards recognition event. And again, someone from our division, Andre Lewis, was asked to reflect on his experience at DePaul in his 15 years of service. So thank you, Andre, and congratulations to the 40 of you who were recognized for that. Now I wonder, there are 6 of you who were still at DePaul who were hired in 15 years ago. I wonder if I asked you to stand if you remember the year. John, you want to start? John Bockenstedt, hired 15 years ago.
Do I remember what year I was hired?
You have to. You want to stand and be recognized? John, Lynette Bishop, Wei Wang, Lynn Kopp, Jessica Holler, and Mark Perillo. So welcome to 15 years. And also, because I looked at the roster, which I always do, I looked at the roster of all the employees, and keeping with the number 15, I looked at the 15 who have been here the longest, and I discovered that I am the 15th longest serving employee. Kind of shocked me, kind of scared me at the same time. But the 14 who have served longer than I are Maureen, Susie Wachowski, Gwen Friend, Mark Elson, Pam Scanlon. Pam, are you still awake? Pam was afraid that she might not off. Sherry Spurko, Lydia, Diana Agundis, Juanita Franklin, Kevin Bradshaw, Patty Huerta, Tina Tyndall, and Daryl Arrington, who beat me by 4 days. So I have tremendous respect for the 14 ahead of me, and I am grateful to be in your good company in terms of years of service. Also, when I prepare my remarks for the annual meeting, I reflect on why I am here. It's easy for me to think about all the good people, and it's easy for me to really reflect on that. So in keeping with the 15 years, or the number 15, I want to give you the 15 reasons and they are in no particular order. 15 reasons why I love being at DePaul. I actually hope that at least one of these might resonate with you and that you can relate to one or more of them. So one of my reasons is the students. I know it sounds trite because we're all here because of the students, but I love seeing the success of our students. I love seeing the role that we all have in that student success, no matter if it's processing an application or helping our students get a job. We all have a role. I've had an interesting glimpse into the success of our students through the EDGE program and also working in the Career Center. So it is one of the reasons why I love working at DePaul. It's one of the reasons I like roaming and being on Lincoln Park, coming to the Lincoln Park campus. Also, it's my colleagues. There is absolutely no doubt that I wouldn't be here 28, almost 29 years if it weren't for the people I get to work with each and every day. Another reason is our mission. I truly believe that those who are drawn to DePaul's mission simply find greater joy in their work. And I think I find that day after day with my colleagues here. Another reason is the work. I absolutely just love what we do. I think we do important work, not only for our students, but for the community and the country at large. I love Chicago. Who could ask for a better city than Chicago? So I love to be working here in the city. Okay, and I also have to admit, I love the benefits. I love the fact that that we have good health insurance and tuition benefits, so I also love that. One of the things I also love are the challenges that we face. Higher ed today is much, much different than when I entered the field. Now it's 30 plus years when I entered it. It's much different, but the challenges are real, and I think I love a good challenge. One of the other reasons I love working at DePaul is that oftentimes I find that there's forgiveness. I feel like there's forgiveness and from people who cut me some slack and forgive some of my shortcomings. I also think that other people share or have the same thing, that you can forgive mistakes, we can forgive each other, and I hope that continues. Which leads me to the next, there's respect. There's a genuine respect for the work we do and the talents that each and everyone brings to work each day. I do love that. Along those same lines, I like the kindness and compassion that I see. If you see Connie from Irma today, I'd like you to ask her the story about what she did for a woman in need that showed true kindness, true compassion, and true generosity. So I ask you, in our social hour, to ask Connie about that. So I am very honored and I am very grateful to have you as colleagues, and that is what every day of the week that I come in here, it's what makes me tick and makes me happy to be here. And finally, my number 15 reason of why I love being at DePaul is that I really like my boss. And with that, I would like to introduce my boss to you, David Kalsbeek.
Jane already led us in acknowledging the good work of Brady and Sandra and Lauren and Nadia in coordinating today's event. In addition to that, if you'd join me in thanking Jane for what she does in shepherding the whole thing. thanks in addition to what you bring to the program. Every year when we do our evaluation afterwards, we consistently hear that what people appreciate is the great personal, genuine warmth that Jane brings to the program, and that everybody appreciates that. And I'm sure that because it stands in such stark contrast to what always follows her on the program. Thank you. And thanks for the history that you walked us through. It's no wonder I feel tired over all those years, and peddling hard to keep up with the good work and all the initiatives and innovations that all of you in this room have brought forward over all the years. It really is kind of breathtaking. To think about all the things that exist now that are so successful, that are really ingrained in the fabric and fiber of how this university operates, that have been initiatives, innovations, ideas that have come from all of you, and I appreciate that, and it really is kind of staggering. Last year when we were here and we gathered, I would have bet good money at that time that by this time, when we would meet, that Hillary would be in the White House and that we would be preparing for another year with Father Dennis as the president of the university. I would have lost both the bets in that regard. We're preparing now for two presidential transitions, in transitions underway in D.C. and the one that will be going on here at the university. And so I'd like to comment briefly, just to start off, on what that means for us. First of all, in terms of presidential transitions in Washington, you know, regardless of where you may be on the political spectrum, I think you would agree that one of the consequences of the November election of Donald Trump is that it's created an environment of some uncertainty for all of us in so many ways. The likely impact on higher education is particularly unclear. And it's not hard to list what those are. The impact of the travel ban and the rippling consequences around the world of that is not likely to have a great direct impact on DePaul. We only have about 25 students from the countries that were included in the initial ban, if you will. At least those students who are here, that even there are on visas. There are concentrations of these students in some of our programs, particularly some of our graduate programs, and so the consequences of however this pans out could be very real for some of our programs and some of our colleges. And we have a lot of efforts underway to work with these students, but institutions coast to coast are seeing a drop off in applications from the international students, from students overseas. That's not too surprising. And because it just may be that the consequence of what's going on here simply may be eroding the degree to which some students from other countries may feel that they'd be welcome in the U.S. or even able to come here to continue to further their education. How it's going to affect us, time will tell. The impact of the president's intended policies on immigration are perhaps more bothersome, with a more direct impact on DePaul. We estimate that we have 150 or so enrolled students who are undocumented, if you will, the dreamer students. But the number of students we have from families who are impacted by whatever happens in terms of immigration policies is really quite high and certainly quite worrisome. Again, what kind of impact will the evolving immigration issues have on DePaul students and other members of our community? Again, time will tell. The consequences of the appointment of Betsy DeVos as the Secretary of Education is also unclear. She doesn't have a real strong track record in higher ed issues. Most of it's in K through 12. But it's safe to say, I think, that many programs run out of the Department of Education, not the least of which is the federal aid programs. Safe to say, we can't just assume that those are going to be untouched. It's been mentioned in the Trump campaign and since the election that the direct lending program, federal lending program begun under President Clinton, may be a target to shift student loans back to private banking and reducing the role of the Department of Ed in that process, perhaps. Again, time will tell. The market that we face for many of our academic programs has dealt with the ebbs and flows of the for-profit sector in higher education. It dramatically expanded, then it really began to contract, primarily under federal scrutiny and regulatory oversight. It began to shut down some of the trajectories of growth in the for-profit schools, universities. That federal oversight is likely to change in this administration with Republican control of both houses. Of Congress, and that for-profit sector may rebound. That'll have an impact on DePaul. Time will tell. Most directly, and I think and most apparently already today, the impact of all of this on campus climate is very real, not just at DePaul, but at campuses coast to coast. We've had our share of instances of campus unrest, conflict, and the increasingly contentious environment that, while maybe not a result of the election, it certainly has changed in tone and intensity in the aftermath of the presidential campaign and the results. A university, we all know, should be a community of where those with opposing points of view can engage in open and honest and yet difficult conversations about the issues of the day. And yet at campuses coast to coast, as we know, we're finding that addressing these issues is increasingly creating anxiety, facing some real intolerance and conflict. All I can say, in looking at all this, is that we have to hunker down to see what kind of impact on higher education in general, and at DePaul specifically, what kind of impact will play out from the political climate in Washington and in the nation. But as citizens, what's becoming clearer to us every day is the undeniable value of an educated citizenry, the undeniable reality that we need to have a society that values education and values the critical thinking that it engenders. And the future is going to be challenging, but for colleges and universities need to rise to respond to those challenges. That's particularly essential. So I hope you consider yourself fortunate, as I do, to work in an industry that, particularly in this society now more than ever, is absolutely essential. Now, meanwhile, at DePaul, we have our own presidential transition. It's coming up, not nearly as fraught with anxiety and uncertainty, and we hope. As you know, we completed a successful national search for a new president, and the university's rolled out quite a welcome for Dr. Gabriel Escalon, currently president of Seton Hall University. I'll just make a few comments in that regard as we prepare for his arrival this summer. First, this was the first executive search at DePaul in my memory here that was closed, if you will. They didn't parade candidates through a series of highly public forums that were intended to involve the whole campus community in meeting the candidates. In this search, only our board of trustees, our executives, and a few small committees representing students, staff, faculty, and senior management participated in the selection process. The hope and the expectation was that this process would successfully keep the search highly confidential, and it did that quite successfully. And that enabled us to attract a stronger pool of candidates, because increasingly current sitting university presidents are reluctant to interview for new positions if that search process is highly public. And so we successfully completed that process. Real tribute to our board and people who participated in that. Secondly, this is, obviously, our first president who's not a Vincentian priest, our first lay president. The fact is that the majority of Catholic colleges and universities now have, in the U.S., now have lay men and women as their chief executive officers. So we're hardly unique. In fact, we're kind of late to the game in that transition. But I can assure you that the entire candidate pool in the presidential search was, they all exhibited a deep appreciation for, respect for Vincentian values, the Vincentian tradition, their prior experience. All of them demonstrated a personal and career commitment to Catholic higher education, and Dr. Esteban was especially strong in that regard. Third is, as I look at candidates for presidents, it's the resume matters more than the interviews, hands down. And Dr. Esteban's experience at Seton Hall is what made him my own preference right from the outset. We've had many experiences over the years, and with executives who've come to DePaul from universities that were so dissimilar from DePaul that these folks were really incapable of effectively managing and even leading DePaul, because their prior experience was irrelevant at best. Seton Hall, on the other hand, is very similar to DePaul University. It's an urban Catholic university that's highly tuition dependent. It has an academic and financial profile that's decidedly kind of middle market, very much like DePaul. It has a good mix of grad and undergraduate programs. It has a clear commitment to diversity, a strong commitment to supporting and serving students. Play in the Big East Conference. They see and embrace academic innovation and academic programs as a critical path to success. They're not in pursuit of prestige for prestige's sake. You're right down the line. Seton Hall is very similar to DePaul in many ways. They're about half our size in enrollment, faculty, staff, overall. But other than that, it's very similar, and that bodes well for DePaul as we go into this transition period. So we're gearing up for a transition. According to our, as Jane just went through with the staffing, and when we look at it, 75% or so, about 3 out of every 4 of you have only been at DePaul under Father Holtschneider's leadership. And so we've seen provosts come and go, we've seen CFOs come and go, but we've been pretty stable in the presidency at DePaul. Certainly with Father Dennis's tenure is about twice as long as the average tenure for university presidents. But we haven't known much of this. Most of you haven't. Presidential transitions can be can be challenging. Every president brings a set of preferred approaches to how they manage their team, how they communicate with the campus community, how they go about strategic planning, to their academic priorities, to their organizational structures, and yes, to enrollment strategy. Lots can change, and again, time will tell on how this all unfolds and what it means for all of us. But Dr. Esteban inherits a university that's facing certainly a very uncertain future, and no small part because we're in a city and in a state that face very uncertain futures, particularly economically. But he also knows that DePaul has a track record and is in a financial position that's the envy of many universities. I can assure you that he does consider himself fortunate coming to DePaul. And in my experience, any executive, senior administrator who arrives here when they come seeing more opportunities than barriers, seeing more advantages than disadvantages, that makes all the difference. And Dr. Esteban is certainly coming to a university that he holds in high regard, and he will seek to build on our successes while tackling our many challenges, and we're all very excited about his arrival. Our task, our collective task in the meantime, before he arrives in the summer, is to prepare material for him to review and get him up to speed as quickly as possible, preparing summaries of our strategies, how we allocate our resources, what our priorities are, what we see as our greatest challenges, what are the strategic approaches that are underway. And that's certainly one of our priorities going in through the rest of this academic year is to prepare that to help him with his onboarding, as they say. So other than a new president, other than two new presidents, what do we have to look forward to for the rest of this year? It's one of the questions that's often posed. I read with great interest a recent supplement in the Chronicle of Higher Education that outlined the top 10 trends in higher education for 2017. If you didn't see it, I strongly commend it to your attention and for your reading. According to the Chronicle, when they listed their top 10 trends for 2017, seven of those top 10 issues at colleges and universities this year have to do with issues of campus climate and campus culture. It included the increasing demands on many campuses to create the campuses as sanctuaries for undocumented students facing the threat of deportation and the general anxiety about safety and security surrounding that issue. It has to do with the growing number of homeless and hungry students that we're finding on our campuses. There's the growing chasm between what are generally liberal thinking and left-leaning colleges and universities, and the chasm between that and the increasing conservative citizenry. There's issues related to sexual misconduct and harassment. Campuses are responding to the issues of safety on campus. There's First Amendment issues related to free speech, hate speech on campus, and intellectual intolerance. Seven of the 10 top trending issues were of that ilk, issues of campus climate and culture and equity and social justice. Interesting. Two of the dominant trends, two other additional dominant trends, had to do with student learning outcomes, which I found interesting in its own right. The two of the top 10 trends had to do with student learning. One was the extent to which the need for professionals in cybersecurity fields is outpacing what universities are producing. And all you have to do is turn on the nightly news and realize that cybersecurity is an issue of the day, and universities need to rise to that challenge. The other trend was the growing focus on information literacy as a key learning outcome for college-educated citizens, producing college graduates capable of telling fact from fiction, of making evidence-based decisions and evidence-based opinions, of knowing an alternative fact when they see one. again, sadly, we need these skills more than ever. And so those are two of the trends that we saw. Finally, only one of the top 10 trends that the Chronicle noted had to do with enrollment, really, and that was the changing legal environment surrounding university efforts to achieve enrollment diversity and all the legal parameters and the court cases surrounding strategies for racial and ethnic diversity in enrollments. So what struck me in these top 10 trends were the things that were on the list, but what wasn't on the list? Because the overarching reality that we all face, certainly private colleges and universities, increasingly public, and the single greatest challenge that we face is essentially flat net tuition revenue. Forecast any way we look at it in the face of the enrollment challenges, that the flat is the new growth in colleges and universities. Now, maybe technically that's not a current trend because it's the outcome of some things that have existed for a long, long time. We've been dealing for years with an increasingly unaffordable tuition. We've been dealing with increasing student debt. We've been dealing with declining demographics, increasing competitiveness, rising costs, heavier and heavier regulatory and compliance burden, all these things. But the degree to which that's resulting in flattening out our revenue trajectories, this is increasing, and there's no end in sight. And I share this because our ability as colleges and universities, and particularly as in line with our Vincentian values and mission, our ability to address all those other trending issues of social justice and civility and tolerance and equity and opportunity, they all assume that we are financially viable. We can only address these other higher order goals if, in fact, we are, as they say in the business literature, a going concern, a financially viable enterprise. We have to have the operating margins that allow us to afford and to pursue our educational purposes and institutional missions. And so the good news is DePaul is doing, I think, a remarkable job in striking that balance. On the one hand, we're addressing these other trending factors and realities in giving extraordinary level of attention to the campus climate and to supporting our students and our faculty and staff in these times. There's been prompt and continuous outreach to the students, international students, both directly impacted by travel ban and beyond that. We've expanded our services and our outreach for our undocumented students. There are tireless efforts to help our student groups, our student organizations, address and resolve in civil ways their disagreements regarding things like controversial speakers on campus, and try to resolve those in a way that promotes greater intellectual tolerance. We're establishing new processes and policies regarding Title IX requirements around and addressing issues of sexual harassment, sexual misconduct, and safety on campus. We're seeking ways to better support all the staff on campus who are equally caught up in the anxiety and the pain of these campus conflicts that we're finding with student groups and how that impacts the entire community. Now, for much of this kind of activity, DePaul looks to our colleagues in student affairs, in university ministry, university mission, Office of Diversity, Office of International Programs, and so on. But likewise, and increasingly, DePaul also needs to continue to invest in strategies to ensure that long-term financial success that comes with enrollment growth and that comes with enrollment stability. And for this, DePaul looks to you, to us, to this division, to work closely with our colleges and with our faculty to support things like the continuous creation of new academic programs that respond to market realities. We have two new programs being proposed, undergraduate programs in data science that are working their way through the process, recognizing the extraordinary job opportunities in data science and big data, if you will, that exist out there. We have a new proposed degree program for more of a focus in engineering in our college, CDM. Created a new major just recently in neuroscience, which is dramatically growing in the College of Science and Health, and on and on. We're also grappling with, I think, with really laser focus on the longstanding challenges facing some programs that we have at DePaul that are in decline and have been in decline for some time. The School of Law is facing just declining interest nationally in the JD degree, and that decline, we don't see that turning around anytime soon. And we're working hand in hand with law on how do you bring the cost structure within a law school in line with declining enrollment. See the same reality in the School for New Learning, and in fact, and how trends in adult student enrollment are impacting that college. We're investing in new systems. Jane talked about some of these things that are underway. We're addressing new systems to improve our efficiencies and our effectiveness. And EM is leading the way in the implementation of Slate, the implementation of the Civitas Learning platform, and so on. We're increasing our staff, despite general reduction of resources and staffing university-wide, we're increasing our support, financial support, staff support for high-impact strategies like the CEO strategy, new digital advertising efforts, new scholarship strategies to support growth in graduate programs, new retention efforts, new brand research to help our colleges and our academic programs clarify and differentiate themselves in this market. New partnerships with our colleges in helping to improve the career outcomes of students and improve the degree to which our students believe that their DePaul degree is worth their investment. And I can go on and on and on about the good work that's underway with all of you in all of our departments, all of which are intended to help stabilize, to help increase, to help improve the university's academic vitality and financial viability that enables us then to address the other trending issues that are that desperately need attention. All that we do, all that you do, is pivotal to ensuring DePaul's future in these uncertain times. And so it's achieving our enrollment goals is, like I said, at the center of what we need to do academically and financially. And so amidst all this uncertainty of presidential transitions and in the face of the challenges related to campus culture and climate, we need to remain focused on DePaul's enrollment and student success, because only then can DePaul, in its proud tradition, continue to address many mission-based commitments to social justice and the like. And so when we think about new strategies that are underway, it brings me to my final comments, and that has to do with our partnership with Rosalind Franklin University that was mentioned in our timeline. And I think it represents the single most strategic, kind of game-changing effort underway at DePaul. And this coming year, we'll see an increasingly active review of this partnership. And so I'd like to just bring you all briefly up to speed on what's underway in that regard. And the Rosalind Franklin, if you're not familiar, Rosalind Franklin is a university. It's Rosalind Franklin University of Medicine and Sciences. It's about 2,000 students located in North Chicago. It's immediately adjacent to the Jim Lovell Federal Health Center and the Great Lakes Naval Reserve Center, about 40 miles or so north of here. Rosalind Franklin is the home of the Chicago Medical School, which, with about 800 students, that accounts for about a third of the enrollment at that university. It's 800 students. It's a very large medical school. By the way, it's the second largest medical school in Illinois after the University of Illinois. It has more applications for admission than all but five med schools in the U.S. It has about the same average MCAT score for their entering students as Loyola Medical School. Like DePaul, it was established to provide medical education. It's back in 1912. Provide medical education in Chicago to students of Jewish faith, students of color, working adults, women, at a time when other medical schools didn't provide that opportunity. We share a very similar mission and history in that regard. Rosalind Franklin is also home to the Scholl School of Podiatry, founded by Dr. Scholl. Yes, that Dr. Scholl. And actually, the Scholl School of Podiatry has produced about one-third of all podiatric doctors in the country. It's a remarkable heritage, founded at the same time, Chicago Medical School in 1912, with the same kind of mission. It's just all really kind of focused from the angle down on what they do. It's a remarkable program with a remarkable science. Both of those schools were established in Chicago, both relocated in this North Chicago location in the mid-late 70s. The Rosalind Franklin is also home to the College of Health Professions, which has about 700 students enrolled in programs such as Physician Assistants, which is one of the finest physician assistant programs in the country. Physical Therapy, a highly regarded program. They have the largest master's program in Pathology Assistants in the U.S. Rosalind Franklin is home to a new School of Pharmacy that was established just in 2012. And it already has such demand that it's in the top five schools of pharmacy nationally in terms of the number of applicants for available seats in that program. So it's Rosalind Franklin, it's a remarkable place, and it's recognized nationally as one of the finest examples of interprofessional education. These students in all these different programs learn together in their classrooms, because when they get into the healthcare environment, they will be working together. Nurses, with physical therapists, with physician assistants, with doctors, they work as a team in the current healthcare environment. Rosalind Franklin has pioneered an approach where they learn as a team in similar classes and academic and educational experiences, and it's a remarkable thing to learn about. I thought, because most of you aren't familiar with it, I thought it'd be helpful to share some pictures of the Rosalind Franklin campus just to give you a kind of a sense of this place. And so we found it. See if this works. Oh, that's me. That's us. That's them. We found a couple pictures of the campus, so we started to roll them together and show some pictures of the place. It's kind of the outdoor of the campus. This is one of their simulation labs, as they've kind of pioneered the use of simulation lab and instruction. But we really found the pictures that were available, that we didn't really have a very good stock, and so Jane and Brady and Sandra, they suggested that when I was up there on campus last Friday, that I take a few pictures just to add to this, presentation. So I took a few, and I emailed them to Sandra, and so maybe on second thought, we'll just come back, and I'll show the rest of my of these slides while we have our happy hour afterwards. So just wait and see those then, and give you a sense of the place at Rosalind Franklin from the pictures that I took while I was visiting. So just to wrap up, a sense of the timeline. In 2008, the president at Rosalind Franklin approached DePaul and to explore opportunities for a strategic partnership with us. And after several years of discussion in 2012, as you saw on your timeline, in 2012 we launched the Alliance for Health Sciences, a partnership with Rosalind Franklin that had several component parts. One was we committed to a schedule of some guaranteed payments to Rosalind Franklin that enabled them to build a new Centennial, what they call their Centennial Learning Center, a significant expansion of their academic facilities. So that was part of our obligation. Into that new space, we then expanded our School of Nursing, and we extended and created a cohort for our Masters of Nursing Practice at the Rosalind Franklin campus that has grown and increased our market share in the EMM market from 13 to 26%, thank you for it. By expanding our program, our existing School of Nursing, to the Rosalind Franklin campus, give us an opportunity to introduce nursing to that campus, as nursing was the one program they didn't have, and expand our program as well. We also began developing our Pathway Honors programs, which are pipelines for undergraduates coming into DePaul to accelerate their entrance into these highly competitive professional fields, PA, PT, medicine, pharmacy. In some cases, even to gain early admission, where at the end of their freshman year, some of these students are already assured admission into these highly competitive professional programs at Rosalind Franklin. Our Pathway program is one of our fastest growing academic programs. It's attracting not only a highly diverse student population, but a student profile that's really at the cream of the crop in terms of their academic profile. Unlike the honors caliber students in health sciences nationally and at Rosalind Franklin, when you look at the diversity of those populations, it tends to be disproportionately Asian American population. For DePaul, our Pathway programs are disproportionately, when we look at the diversity of that population, about half are white. Predominantly it's Hispanic, African-American pipeline into these highly competitive academic fields and health professions. It's a win-win-win all the way around. We began investing in some shared research projects where our faculty collaborate with Rosalind Franklin faculty on and some biomedical wide range of research that has panned out in a number of published papers. I got a federal grant in support of one of these projects. I think we've got a patent now on some of the work that's been done, our faculty working with their faculty. The Alliance was a six-year plan, and we're going into our fourth and fifth year of this, and one of the goals was by this time we would begin to evaluate what's working in this Alliance and begin a university-wide review of whether or not a more permanent, deeper integration of the two universities, what that would look like, and what benefits that would create. And we are very actively reviewing that now at this stage in this partnership. Our trustees have established a task force to review this. They're exploring these next steps. We're working very closely with them in that regard. And in fact, that was my last visit on Friday to Rosalind Franklin, was to accompany a number of our trustees to go to Rosalind Franklin to get a more in-depth, up-close view of that university. And one particularly ambitious option that exists and a model that we want to explore is where the Rosalind Franklin its programs and its campus become really part of the DePaul portfolio of programs, where the degrees granted there are considered DePaul degrees, where their alumni, the alumni of these programs are DePaul alumni, and so on, and where, as a result, DePaul would become, through that kind of a tighter alliance, DePaul would become a major player in health profession education, which we certainly are not now. If we were to somehow combine the Rosalind Franklin array of programs with the programs that DePaul currently offers, we would have a wider array and a larger market share in health profession education than any other university in the state other than University of Illinois. We certainly would outpace Loyola in terms of the range and the size of our health profession education. Clearly, taking the DePaul name, the DePaul brand, if you will, improves and increases Rosalind Franklin's visibility and name recognition. Now, while those students who are in the health fields and those practitioners in the health fields are well aware of Rosalind Franklin as evidenced in their application volume, they don't have broad name recognition. The Rosalind Franklin name has only been part of their identity for 12 years. They were Fitch University before that and had other names before that. Nevertheless, Rosalind Franklin doesn't immediately come to mind. Being aligned with the DePaul brand name would certainly help in that visibility. Vice versa, having these health programs in our portfolio would certainly build the DePaul brand, certainly build our reputation, and allow us to build programs that are more robust than the current pathway programs are in preparing undergraduates for the rapidly growing career opportunities in health fields. Developing any of these programs on our own independently is simply cost prohibitive. We'd never be able to get off the ground. We don't have the resources. We don't have the expertise. So finding a way to integrate existing programs at a place like Rosalind Franklin within the DePaul family is a far more promising strategy for entry into this market, if you will. Both universities would benefit strategically, but a tight institutional alignment like this, they are as difficult as they are rare between two independent universities, and it requires some real risk-taking on behalf of both institutions to be able to do that. Can we muster the will at DePaul to do it? Well, like everything else I said today, time will tell. Clearly much depends on how our new president is going to feel about such a strategy and such an initiative. But the fact that Dr. Esteban at Seton Hall led the establishment of a new medical school and the expansion of a health campus certainly suggests that he'll understand the strategic value of what we've been considering here at DePaul now for a number of years. So the fact is, I can imagine, and I imagine you can imagine, a future where the scope of what we talk about in our annual gatherings like this will include a historic medical school. It'll include groundbreaking biomedical research. We'll be talking about bringing freshmen directly into a college of pharmacy, directly into a physician assistance program, directly into physical therapy, and so on. I can imagine that future. I'm excited about exploring that kind of a future, and I believe that it's actually within our grasp. If we choose to move in that direction, it would be transformative for DePaul, and it would also extend our mission in exciting new ways. As I often point out to our trustees, there are far more hospitals in this country with the name St. Vincent on it than there are law firms and accounting firms. Being in health education is quite consistent with our founding mission, but it also would help ensure our financial vitality and academic vitality as well, sustainability. So all I can say is, time will tell. And so that's all the news for now from Lake Wobegon, and so I want you to enjoy the social hour. It really is the primary purpose, perhaps the primary purpose for our gathering is for opportunities for you to interact with colleagues that you don't have the opportunity to necessarily to see on a day-to-day basis. Introduce yourself again, as you did at the outset, to someone you don't already know. Enjoy our time together. If you have any questions on any of this, feel free to ask. And while we enjoy our time together, you can enjoy the rest of my pictures from Rosalind Franklin on the campus. Thanks again for all you do. Have a great spring quarter. Thank you.